educated at Stanford and then Case Western Reserve University School of Medicine with postgraduate training in urological surgery at the Texas Medical Center. He served as president of the ICIM and as the first physician president of the IABDM, all right? And he was awarded certification in biological dentistry, all right, except for the fact that he's not a dentist. All right. In recognition of several books and many innovative approaches in clinical medicine, he was recognized by the ICIM with their Distinguished Lifetime Achievement Award and was honored by Marquis Who's Who as a top doctor in advanced medicine and as recipient of their Lifetime Achievement Award. He maintains an active clinical practice in Houston, Texas. Please welcome to the stage, Dr. John Trowbridge.
If you can remember something simple like IN, immunity, inflammation, and infection, is this rooting out all degenerative diseases? Well, yeah, kind of like. So MMN, relax and enjoy this and be open to looking at new ways about this. You'll see how these are three sides of the same coin, and they are contributing to progressive cellular damage that results in deteriorating organ function. Of course, that's disease. And you'll see how modern testing techniques and these, you know, we're using more and more of them, and they have challenged some of the basic tenets taught in medical education. They've limited those basic tenets that have limited our ability to see the details, so that now we can finally step back and see the big picture. And you'll see how human survival, despite the onslaught of infection and oxidative stress, impaired system functions, is indeed the miracle of life. I mean, it's amazing that we actually survive at all, and you can see new ways to treat patients with chronic debilitating diseases. So this is a concept presentation. The slides are available. Relax. Don't worry about writing down details. I want you to look more for the forest, and the pattern made by the trees may not be quite as important. So let's talk about where in the world is Waldo? Well, Waldo is hiding in plain sight. So where in the world is Mensa? Well, Mensa is hiding in plain sight. Now, Mensa, very wise old owl, will guide us today. And what can we learn from Mensa? Let's kind of sniff out the real nucleus of this. Well, the nucleus of effective treatment involves body responses to immune challenges, inflammatory triggers, and pathogens of all kinds, because these are effectively the same, all three of those, because these are interrelated responses that are equal partners in the same system. Immune and autoimmune diseases, I mean, which doctor do we want to refer them to? See, the clinical immunologist, the allergist, or rheumatologist, or dermatologist, everybody is, you know, this big turf war, okay? Inflammatory diseases, the rheumatologist or diagnostician or internist or some organ-specific specialist. And of course, infections, well, we have infectious disease specialists. I've always found those useful, right? Parasitologists, not very many of those around. Dermatologists may be helpful. Family medicine specialist, organ-specific specialist. Well, you know, dentists had their similar specialists as well. The endodontists, the oral and maxillary, facial surgeons, periodontists, biological dentists. Of course, we're still mapping out the turf. We know common diseases aren't so common in their causes, despite our reductionist approach that one size fits none. But, you know, people appear to recover or at least tolerate our common diseases with their medications and operations, dental interventions. The challenge comes with diseases where we don't recognize a cause, and therefore the question from the patient is, doctor, why did I get this? And we don't know, but we have cortisone, we have chemotherapy, and that's commonly an answer to so many of the puzzling illnesses where we don't seem to have an answer. So Mensa asks, what could we see if we could see what's real. We actually had a handle on what's really going on down under these illnesses. Well, in immunity, you know, we've got all these different little pieces interacting. We've had some wonderful presentations in the last couple of days about all these different interactions and what turns on and what suppresses and so on. And the same happens with inflammation, where we understand more and more of the triggers and the processes. And the same with infection, and of course, there's the various different kinds. So Mensa concludes that immunity, inflammation, and infection are effectively the very same processes occurring inside the human body in quite an interesting dance. So Mensa asks you to remember M-N-N. Now think of that as the three musketeers, okay? One for all for one, three sides of the same coin. Now it's real interesting to be able to see some of this, because immunity and inflammation are well understood to be in a cycle inside us and in the environment. Immunity and infection are well understood as cycles inside us and the environment. And so Mensa invites us to look a little deeper at immunity. Now, the immune response is how your body recognizes and defends itself against bacteria, viruses, other organisms, and substances that appear foreign and harmful. And so we have the innate immunity, the basic stuff, and then adaptive immunity, where we're really looking at new challenges and such and coming up with answers to it. Well, the immune system is always on alert. The innate immunity, the rapid response, is sorting out what we're going to respond to, and the adaptive immunity comes along finally and does the cleanup of what we decide to attack. And of course, that's one of the problems when you get immune tolerance, is you stop deciding to attack. Well, MNN, innate immunity, adaptive immunity, I'm saying that this system is all one system, with immunity, inflammation, and infection. Let's take a look at vitamin C with immunity. Vitamin C is maintained at high levels in most immune cells and can affect many aspects of the immune response. In fact, one of our ICIM members, Don Roberts, says the whole purpose of the defense system is to deliver vitamin C to an area under attack. Yeah, that's pretty important stuff, because the diseases of inflammation often respond to antioxidants, and that can be understood from the fact that oxidative damage is now associated with a variety of diseases, including the cancers, neurodegeneration, diabetes, and so on. There's a critical nexus then with immunity and inflammation. The immune system includes certain types of white blood cells, but also chemicals and proteins in the blood, such as antibodies, complement proteins, interferon, and so on. Now, some of these attack foreign substances directly. Others work together to help stimulate and assist the immune cells. So Mensa observes, vitamin C, immunity, and infection seems to have an important role in the maintenance of a healthy immune system, and its deficiency causes immune insufficiency and multiple infections. Looks like they're joined at the hip. Ascorbic acid improves the phagocytic properties and activity of various immune system cells, neutrophils, natural killers, macrophages, lymphocytes. It increases lymphocyte proliferation in the body and antibody production. So Mensa invites us now to look at inflammation. Now, we know the five cardinal signs of inflammation: pain, heat, redness, swelling, loss of function. And thermography very easily kind of identifies that whole graphic picture for us. And harmful exposures are associated with immunity and inflammation. It's the immune system's response to harmful stimuli, such as pathogens, damaged cells, toxic compounds, or radiation. It acts by removing injurious stimuli and initiating the healing process. And, you know, we learn in the second year in med school, inflammation is the number one step in healing and repair. And then in the third year, we learn how to prescribe anti-inflammatories. That makes sense. Okay. Inflammation is therefore a defense mechanism vital to health, and of course we know all the stories about free radical stresses, and that oxidative stress literally is associated in every disease and system in the body. Now there are two types of inflammation. There's the acute and the chronic. The acute generally is just a very short duration, can be seconds, minutes, perhaps up to a few days. It's the normal healing we see when you get a scratch or a cut and so on. Now, the chronic inflammation is where we start getting more issues. That's where days can prolong into years, even a lifetime. It's a whole different set of cells, mainly macrophages and lymphocytes, and you get proliferation of the blood vessels, which you wouldn't normally see much in the acute phase, fibrosis, tissue necrosis, that's damage, and you have fewer and fewer neutrophils in that system. The acute or good inflammation is the trigger that sets off the healing pattern and the body releases and does its job. The chronic or bad inflammation is where it just didn't go on to healing and kind of got stunned and stymied in the way, and the body starts to release inflammatory compounds to keep signaling, I'm in trouble, I'm in trouble, I'm in trouble, and that brings in a whole raft of different biochemical responses, again, to the same beginning. So acute versus chronic inflammation, you know, acute's like allergic and chemical irritants, infection leads to the acute inflammation, trauma and injury, burns, cuts, frostbite, and so on. The chronic inflammation leads to all these degenerative diseases that we've outlined as the free radical diseases, the cardiovascular, neurological, autoimmune, rheumatoid arthritis, cancer, lupus, fibromyalgia, and chronic fatigue syndrome. And you can look at it from this situation, chronic inflammation just leads to a blast of everything. It's like a bomb going off inside the body. Whatever are the weakest systems inside your body or your patient's body, that's what we're going to get to see in the chronic inflammation pattern. So, you know, it's kind of common to see people, they've got one of these, start looking for the others because the next systems under stress will be starting to show their damage as well. And remember, we're talking about the conditions linked to chronic inflammation are the killers. Cardiovascular disease and cancer, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, because stroke is number 3, cancer's in the middle. But then we're suffering a lot with autoimmune conditions now. Didn't used to have all these autoimmune conditions. We're seeing more and more of them as time goes by. And of course, joint pain, frequently attributed to chronic inflammation, and that's one of the biggies in the society. If you have a problem with that, just noop it. It's amazing. Okay, chronic inflammation. Inflammatory cytokines are the pathogenesis of multiple diseases, and excessive inflammatory cytokine production leads to tissue damage, hemodynamic changes, organ failure, and ultimately death. So when you're attending a patient who is doing not well at all, they are in a stage of chronic excessive cytokine production, inflammatory production. So let's talk MNN. Cytokines are predominantly released from immune cells, monocytes, macrophages, lymphocytes. Pro- and anti-inflammatory cytokines, the balance, facilitate and inhibit inflammation, respectively. But inflammatory cytokines are classified as ILs and others and are produced by cells primarily to recruit, to bring leukocytes to the site of the infection or injury to begin the healing process. Now, cytokines modulate the immune response to infection and inflammation, and regulate the inflammation. We're beginning to see this picture is just the same. So chronic inflammation, as we talked about before, think of all the diseases that we see in our world. And just because we don't have dental diseases listed on this is irrelevant, because every one of those is every one of these. Chronic inflammation, again, another way of looking at it, I'm going to hit you from several different directions because I want you to be thinking chronic inflammation with every patient that you're seeing. How about inflammation and aging? Remember, what do we die from when we get older? Chronic inflammatory diseases in the heart and the lungs and the kidneys and the liver. We have cancer, we get neurologic diseases which just make us suffer and go down more slowly. And chronic fatigue syndrome, so we can just suffer for years and complain without anybody having a reason to fix us. Metabolic diseases, we're wonderful in the modern era that we've created excessive intake diseases. the cardiovascular, the skin concerns, you know, the wrinkles and the cellulitis, and then the bones, of course, we get not only osteoarthritis and muscular dystrophy, but indeed we get osteoporosis and we fail that way as well. So inflammation is the chemical dance, and there's multiple ways to work this cycle. It doesn't really matter where you enter into it. It's kind of like the Krebs cycle. It just keeps spinning, and that inflammation chemical dance is critical to either restoring health or beginning the chronic diseases that are going to kill you. So vitamin C with regard to inflammation, we saw it with regard to immunity. Antioxidants such as vitamin C and E offer defense against oxidative stress brought on by inflammation and the associated free radicals, unstable molecules that damage the body's cells. In other words, we start with a little matchstick and we can end up with a huge forest fire. And the question is, at what point are we able to snuff the bad and proceed with the good? And that's one of the reasons we need so much more vitamin C now than ever before, because of the increasing, logarithmically increasing stresses inside the system. So vitamin C is considered as a strong anti-inflammatory agent because it inhibits the inflammatory mediators, such as TNF-alpha. And, you know, it's hard to underestimate the importance of some of these things, because as Tim pointed out, just drop one little spot here and a whole ocean of other things follow. Vitamin C with inflammation, the antioxidant property is the anti-aging effect. This is important in protecting cellular integrity. I like to say to people, let me explain aging. It's a disease happening one day at a time. And the rate at which it's happening is the rate at which you appear to be aging. So someone 50 can look 60, someone 50 can look 40, and that 20-year difference is the rate at which they are unable to control the inflammatory processes going on inside. And of course, that deals not just with lipids, but DNA as well, and it protects cellular junctions, critical in maintaining your life. Vitamin C, there's an increasing number of preclinical studies in trauma, ischemia, and reperfusion, and sepsis. Vitamin C administered at pharmacologic doses. This is using it as a drug effect, not as a nutritional one, attenuates the oxidative stress and the inflammation and restores the organ function. You might have heard of the New Zealand rancher who got terribly sick with, as I recall, it was swine flu, and was referred up and up and up to the tertiary hospital, and finally they said to the family, you have to pull the plug. And they said, no, what we've heard about this thing, vitamin C, can't you? No, we don't do that here. They actually happened to contact somebody at the Attorney General's office who wanted to know why they didn't do that there. And indeed, they infused IV vitamin C, and he got better, and they referred him down to the secondary hospital where they don't do that there. Okay, so we stressed that again, got him back to the local hospital where they don't do it. They stopped that fight. They just kept giving it to him orally, and he's back riding horses and ranching. Vitamin C at pharmacologic doses, a la Linus Pauling. How about curcumin and inflammation? Because, you know, we hear of all these herbs and the Chinese things and whatever, and yet we don't often appreciate these are really the prototypical drugs, kind of like aspirin came from willow bark and so on. Well, when you start looking at the influences that these herbs have in these processes, they can be more profound than any of the drugs that you might have available. Just a map showing you about curcumin. Well, chronic diseases, M and N, monocytes differentiate into macrophages and dendritic cells and recruited into the damaged tissues, and inflammation-mediated immune cell alterations are associated with many diseases. We've talked about these as the chronic stress diseases. Looking at the immunity and the inflammation interaction, same thing we find in atherosclerosis. The underlying pathology for most of the deaths, or many of the deaths in disability worldwide, the innate immune system is the primary cardiac defense against pathogens and tissue damage. And when we start seeing failure there, we see the slip into the chronic inflammatory disease pattern. Remember, diabetes is itself an inflammation disease. Insulin deficiency develops, and that's the you get type 2 diabetes, and then you start getting more of an inflammatory change inside. Circulating levels of acute phase proteins, we all know the list of those, have been observed in people who are suffering with type 2 diabetes. It's not sugar, it's inflammation. Of course, sugar is creating the inflammation and the imbalance. And here's the list just so you can see that there's actually some science behind it. All these things elevated in obesity and prediabetes prior to the onset of the type 2 diabetes. So excessive nutrient levels, especially those of glucose and free fatty acids, promote the insulin resistance pattern, activating NF-kappa-B and so on, all these pathways which promote tissue inflammation. I want to remind you, I think the body never makes a mistake. It does exactly what it is supposed to be doing at the time it's supposed to be doing it in that situation. So if you want to change what it does, change the situation. And that's the kind of take-home message idea about how we have to look at this different. Infectious inflammation of the liver, mainly caused by microorganisms, bacterial products, hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, and so on. And of course, liver diseases are increasingly recognized as serious illness. Like deadly. Lung diseases. Lung inflammation results primarily from tissue exposure to bacterial and viral pathogens. Oh, geez, that's not fun stuff. How about pollutants? A major problem more and more. The unresolved lung injury from chronic inflammation are frequently observed in all of the aging diseases and the acute ones that take us out. So MNN, the kidney inflammation contributes to progressive kidney injury, leading to all of the end-stage kidney diseases and so on. Kidney inflammation is most often caused by infection. Inflammation caused by infection. And then you get the insight to immune complex formation and deposition or complement pathway dysregulation. You've got all three of them just lined up right there. The complex polygenetic inflammatory bowel diseases, characterized by an excessive inflammatory response to gut lumen bacteria and other microbial flora, MNN. MNN, you know, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, cytokine-driven things, the list of chemistry. We've seen this time and again. It's the dysfunctional interaction between the gut bacteria and the mucosal immune system. How about brain diseases? Inflammatory diseases occur in the brain, and autoimmune diseases occur in the brain, and all these things are starting to look very interesting because of infection as well. Inflammatory responses in the brain enhance the neuronal excitability, injure the cells, do all sorts of things. These result from the activation of the brain's resident immune defense systems, which are producing pro-inflammatory markers. How about brain damage? CNS inflammation response is a strong reaction to both infectious agents and brain injury. Now, that's interesting because we don't normally hear about infectious agents unless we're talking about encephalitis, meningitis, and so on. The newer research on Alzheimer's and even non-Alzheimer's dementia starting to look very interesting with regard to infection. Inflammation is frequently a key element in the pathological progression of organ diseases. Of course, these are dysregulations of the pathways designed to help handle the problem. So NF-kappa-B transcription plays inflammatory, immune, and then go further down, pathogen-derived substances, immunity, inflammation, infection. Three sides of the same coin. Diseases of inflammation, oxidative stress, multiple diseases, we've shown you examples of these. Oxidative stress products can be used as markers of the inflammatory response. And inflammation control, we actually have chemistry inside our cells designed to do this. They don't actually block inflammation. They don't suppress inflammation. They help facilitate the clearance of the debris so that the healing can proceed. However, that can be blocked or impaired inside people. There's new evidence now available suggesting that pathologic conditions associated with reduced clearance mechanisms contribute to the chronicity and magnitude of persistent inflammation. Remember, it's the chronic inflammation that has us suffer and die. So if we have chronic magnitude increasing inflammation, that impaired resolution is going to lead to acute cardiovascular attacks and the chronic suffering. So resolution keys to treatments, well, there's resolution mediators that can provide unique opportunities to address inflammation and infection. And some of these specialized pro-resolving mediators include resolvents. Those are from fish oils, the EPA family, and protectants, myrcesins and such, lipoxins, which promote the resolution of inflammation and clearance of microbes. It's all tied in to the same picture here. The inflammatory response must be suppressed to prevent additional tissue damage. Otherwise, you know, it's three steps forward, two steps back. Three steps forward, two steps back. You will lose that game. Circulating white blood cells eventually no longer sense that there's a problem, and they aren't recruited to the site of injury any further. Digging at the roots of disease, chronic inflammation occurs when acute inflammatory mechanisms fail, and they may lead to the host of diseases. Here's the picture of the fish oils, the EPA and DHA, leading to the production of resolvents. If the resolvents only last for brief nanoseconds. If they're there where the inflammation is at the time, they can help resolve or move it from irritating inflammation to healing inflammation. If they're not there, there's nothing resolving it at that point. It just continues. If the resolvents are present, that's great. And we do a simple test that shows us kind of the ratio of what's available inside your blood to look at whether you've got enough EPA to provide the resolvents locally in all the tissues, because it doesn't matter where you get inflamed, you still got to be able to fix it. And you would be surprised. This test goes up to a 25 or so. On the graph, I've had people over 100. They're virtually absent of any resolvents. And here's just a nice scientific showing about, you know, how the resolvents work to either go to resolution or chronic inflammation. And infection, same thing. It either goes to resolution or not. Supplement cautions. It's clear that dietary supplements containing N3 fatty acids, the precursors to the resolvents and so on, are not substitutes for prescription drugs. There is considerable variation. You know, when Lily used to have an ad, and it showed a picture of the pill bottle and the capsule and the glass of water, and said, the one the patient takes is never tested. And it's true, they depend on batch testing to ensure that the quality going out is true. Well, there's considerable variation with nutritional supplements in the quantities and quality of many of over-the-counter products, some containing other lipids and auto-oxidation products and so on. The processing is absolutely critical, and your patients will try to save money from slipping past you in any which way. So now Mensa invites us to turn our attention not from immunity and inflammation, but instead to infection. Infection has multifocal issues, and in other words, your body can get weakened from a whole variety of conditions, reduced absorption, anorexia, metabolic damage, iron deficiency, and so on. But basically, they weaken your body's ability to handle things, and you create a malnutrition state that's an open door policy. Infection then leads to inflammation. And this is just a diagram showing it doesn't matter what invades through, it stimulates the different cells that are supposed to respond. Again, showing you more example of the infection creating the inflammation, because that's how your body intends to respond and protect itself. Inflammation can be caused by non-living agents as well. It's always present with infection. Inflammation is always present with infection, and a superimposed infection can occur with inflammation. So now we get infection to inflammation to more infection. Infection is caused by the invasion of cells by microorganisms and is not always present with inflammation. And that is a serious issue because you have not turned on the healing defense mechanism. In that situation, Mensa observes dental infections. Decay and abscess can be quite serious. You know, the picture of the normal tooth with quite a fascinating structure. And, you know, this is easy for dentists, and doctors go, yeah, it's a tooth, okay? But the rinsing flow of the pulp into the dentin is part of what keeps the tooth alive and aware, because it's getting a constant supply of the protective chemicals. Stagnation equals infection. The healthy tooth no longer being nourished by this, the first step in the caries process is the reversal of the dentinal fluid flow rather than the acid attack from the oral environment. Decay, immunity, and infection. Bacterial and other acids in the environment erode the enamel, potentially initiate an inflammatory response in the dentin, and bacteria easily invade the tooth enamel. And dental decay then penetrates as it goes deeper and deeper. Now into the dental pulp, we have a serious, serious infection. And dental decay involves all three: immunity, inflammation, and infection. Dental plaque is obvious infection. It's unlike any other bacterial ecosystem that survives on body surfaces because it develops on the non-shedding tooth surface. You can't just rinse it off like that. It can form complex bacterial communities. We know these as biofilms and things like that. They can harbor over 400 distinct species and contain over 108 bacteria. I saw 108 some million or something bacteria per milligram. It's a bacterial cesspool in the plaque. No one knows how many bacterial species, ribotypes, serotypes, and so on coexist, but the number is huge, and most of them are undescribed species. That's an interesting situation. We think we know everything. Caries versus root canal infections. Bacteria associated with an infected root canal differ from those associated with the cavities the dental caries. And, you know, we have to understand that the infected root canal is a different beast. It is not a cavity. It is a whole different assault and attack on the human body. And in that situation, we're in trouble. Here's an example. This is just a list that I grabbed off one of the articles about asymptomatic infected root canals. Asymptomatic. They don't hurt. They're just there. And all these growth have been documented. Now, Blanche Group's office, the DNA Connections Lab, easily finds these in root canal teeth, all sorts of different things. They are not, incidentally, looking at fungi. These are bacteria. They're not looking at parasites. These are bacteria. They are not looking at viruses. These are bacteria. Could it be that we're just scratching the surface of this? We're just seeing the tip of this iceberg. A sample type of root canal and cavitation, again, courtesy of DNA Connections, see these lists of bacteria. Now remember, we're not dealing with one thing. You know, you go into the doctor, you have strep throat. Oh good, you have strep throat, we're going to give you this for strep. You can't do something like that with a complex infection system like a root canal. So Mensa wonders if periodontitis is perhaps the most threatening of the illnesses that we face commonly that leads to more serious diseases for us. Periodontitis involves M and N, and that means the immunity and the inflammation are responses to the bacterial accumulations. That's the dental plaque on the teeth. The symptomless nature of periodontal disease is one of its defining characteristics. It just kind of lingers there, and it continues to be able to invade deeper and create more and more problems. Now, about 50% of the adult population has gingivitis, the inflammation without any bone loss, really, and not deep pockets. But at any given time, about 30% have periodontitis, which is actually starting to be much more invasive in the human mouth. MNN, periodontitis, associated with expansion of the immune system cells because of the local dysbiotic, the infection in the microbiome, and that turns on the inflammatory cells, which then go into tissue destruction mode because that's part of cleaning up the area and in order to get rid of it. Here's one example that I found of an immune booster that possesses strong antibacterial and anti-inflammatory and gingival protection properties under the periodontitis mimicking conditions. So it suggests we might actually have some treatments coming along that can help us externally stimulate the improvement with periodontitis. But let's look at vitamin C. It accumulates in phagocytic cells, such as neutrophils, can enhance chemotaxis, phagocytosis, generation of reactive oxygen species, ultimately microbial killing. And, you know, when you start looking at this, vitamin C helps innate and adaptive immune functions. It's antibacterial, antiviral, antiparasitic, antifungal. As you keep going through, this is an adjunct in the treatment for in human infections. Now, how many of us see physicians and dentists routinely say, you need a lot more vitamin C? It isn't happening. But, you know, in the emergence of multi-drug resistance, we better be thinking of that because, inflammatory drugs are not that helpful. Chronic inflammation underlies so many diseases, it would make sense to see that's a condition that should be treated in its own right with regard to preventive therapy. In some cases, existing drugs with anti-inflammatory effects are found to actually be effective against a variety of diseases that are resulting from chronic inflammation, as long as you don't use it to cover up the idea that treatment is actually needed. A 2019 review provided an overview of 133 marine, this is sea life, fungi-derived anti-inflammatory compounds, okay? And found that there are a bunch of them. In other words, it's everywhere. It's in the water, it's in the air, it's in the dirt. Inflammatory response in chronic diseases is a highly coordinated network of many cell types associated with response to infection, turning on the immune cell system, and relating to autoimmune and degenerative diseases, the immunity, inflammation, infection. Neutrophils, which target the microorganisms, can damage host cells as well, and they are the key mediators of the inflammatory response, okay? These activate T cells and release local factors, and we're starting to bring in the immune inflammation infection pattern, and that then is the cytokines we've discussed earlier. Platelets impact inflammatory processes from atherosclerosis to infection, and these mediated actions are virtually ignored, but they're some of the earliest ones to actual infection or injury. And after being recruited by inflammatory stimuli, the immune cells amplify the platelet response, releasing local inflammatory mediators. Now, a pathogen is a microorganism that has the potential to cause disease. An infection is the invasion by these pathogens, and a disease is where the infection causes damage to the individual's vital function or systems. So an infection does not always result in a disease. It depends on how well we can control it, doesn't it? CNS diseases, inflammation and infection. This chronic inflammation has been implicated in disorders involving progressive and irreversible damage to the central nervous system. How about the concept of brain-eating microbes, like amoeba? Those can progress very quickly. Brain fungal infections, often misdiagnosed, can progress very quickly. How about brain fungus and Alzheimer's? Very provocative information coming through the literature. And brain bacteria and Alzheimer's. I want to point out fellow travelers. If you got bacteria, you got fungus. If you got fungus, you got bacteria. If you got either one of these, you got parasites. If you got parasites, you got either or the other. If you got viruses, you got those. And it's a whole family of things, because once you're immune system and your inflammation breakdown, every infection is now wide open territory because you're just in wide open door. Brain viruses being looked at for Alzheimer's. And here's just an example of the brain-gut connection. We end up getting illnesses in the gut where the immune and inflammatory control breaks down, and we end up with dysfunction in the brain system as well. How about demented dentistry? Older people with dementia have higher levels of plaque and gingival bleeding, periodontal pockets, stomatitis, mucosal lesions, reduced salivary flow. Huh. I wonder if that plaque could have anything to do with their dementia. Well, CSF data provide evidence that the P. gingivalis infection, so common in mouth, is common in the brain of AD patients, Alzheimer's disease patients as well. Now, also in chronic periodontitis, and you go, wait a minute, that's the one we were talking about so many percentage of the adult population are suffering with. So gum infection, is this progressive? Well, once the oral cavity is infected, P. gingivalis can access the brain and spread by a number of pathways, all of which are going to lead downhill. Are we taking the wrong approach to Alzheimer's disease with leaving it to the neurologists? The treatment with selective KGP protease inhibitor reduces the infection in the brain and slows or prevents further degeneration. With regard to infection-induced neuroinflammation, you can actually look at inflammasomes in the brain, well, not easily, but anyway, they have multiple innate immune defense systems inside immunity, inflammation, infection. So dentists to the rescue, Well, periodontal disease and Alzheimer's disease, maybe if we can prevent tooth loss by improving better dental health, we can improve memory following dental intervention, and that links the microbial contribution from the oral pathogens to the manifestation of chronic conditions like Alzheimer's disease. We're not normally thinking of the chronic illnesses like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and such as related to infections, what should be controllable. We need to be thinking that's what we're missing. Now, what about overlooking the obvious and so very affordable in our system? No clinical trials were reported that tested the effect of periodontal interventions on medical outcomes in atherosclerosis, cardiovascular disease, stroke, rheumatoid arthritis, Alzheimer's, chronic kidney disease, or malignant neoplasia. Why not? Because remember, we've got specialists handling each of these problems, and they're looking their way, not back to an origin way. And the origin way could be oral pathology. It's that simple. The oral systemic nexus, immunity, inflammation, infection, chronic gingivitis, periodontitis associated with age-related diseases, you know the list. The results suggest that it may be an emerging risk factor for small vessel disease-associated vascular disorders, not only in the brain but elsewhere in the body. The risk may be mediated by systemic inflammation resulting from chronic oral infections. Who has chronic oral infections? Everybody. It's that simple. So Mensa asks, should we rethink bacteremia? Well, you know, bacteremia leads to sepsis. You get the bloodstream infection, a wide variety of things. In fact, every time we chew, we're getting some bacteremia. But those generally are controlled because, we've got the immunity and the inflammation to deal with the infection. But, you know, when you get sepsis, it's a serious medical condition that can go downhill literally within hours or days with a high mortality rate. Is it possible that dysregulation of the inflammatory response due to oral infection is really the key to the uncontrolled inflammation leading to tissue and organ damage and resulting in death of the patients? So Mensa asks, should we rethink puzzling diseases? We hear hoofbeats, we're looking for horses. Maybe we ought to be rethinking about zebras. So what causes chronic fatigue syndrome or rheumatoid arthritis or lupus or chronic lymphocytic leukemia? Well, there's the devils you know, the different bacteria and viruses and parasites and such. But what about the devils you don't know? Like fungus and more intriguing parasites. Remember, most parasites are very stealthy and are hard to find, possibly even harder to treat. But, you don't find it. You don't look for it because you don't know about it. You don't treat it if you don't find it. And even if you treat it, you may have a hard time accomplishing that because we're not trained on that in medicine. But there are some obvious fungal diseases. Organs all over the body can be involved in fungus issues. And we indeed have seen, our specialists find these eventually. They're looking for the simpler things and finally find the zebras. But what about sepsis? Could fungemia be a major contributor to sepsis? And so I want to go ahead and just relate this back a little bit. How many people have thrush, chronic thrush? And indeed, the older you get and the more problems you have with your oral dentition, the more problems you can get with fungus infection there, and fungemia may well be a major contributor. Now, genetics can identify some of the things going on there, but, it's getting to be an emerging field of high complexity. All of those things that I just listed for you, the chronic fatigue syndrome, rheumatoid lupus, leukemia, MS, ALS, coronary atherosclerosis, how many more could be related to fungal diseases or other unexposed pathogens? So elegant genetic sequencing studies, the ones I refer to are the next-gen studies from the Fry Labs, have shown evidence of fungal or prokaryotic, eukaryotic organisms recovered from peripheral blood samples. So they're not tapping organs or anything, just looking at what's circulating in the blood. How about this is a biofilm recovered from the blood? Well, there was a mistaken identity that was solved in 2017. Fry reported that DNA sequencing showed a fungus, Phenelophormus mossii, they had previously described as a bacterium. Protomyxoa rheumatica, not at all a bacterium, definitely a fungus. Okay, well, just admit that we learned a little bit better about how that works. So Mensa asks, what is deep blood fungus? Now, you won't find that anywhere. That's my term, because how do you explain to patients, ah, you got this, da-da-da-da-da. So deep blood fungus makes sense, and it doesn't refer just to fungus. It can be Purkinje's species, other prokaryotic, eukaryotic organisms, and this is the top six that they find in the Fry Lab testing. In other words, pathogens in the form of fungi, prokaryocytes, prokaryotes and eukaryotes, and classical parasites as well. The ones that we have been taught a little bit about in school, not much. And that's deeply distressing, because Waldo can be hiding in plain sight. And if you don't know to look, or you don't know how to look, you can easily miss what's obviously there. ALS, interesting enough, see the red dots on the diagram? Those are the ALS patients. The green dots are the MS patients. The ALS patients almost uniformly have a freshwater algae. The MS patients almost uniformly have the finelliformis fungus. They had trouble getting this paper published. It was too controversial. Okay, I thought science was supposed to be controversy. We go against what we currently know or do. Chronic fatigue syndrome. Numerous studies have shown a high incidence of chronic infections in chronic fatigue. Well, these include the viral infections and the various things, the mycoplasma, chlamydia, and so on. But you know, in the Fry Lab studies in 2018, they reported the majority of their samples had Purkinje's, Bumella, or proteobacteria, and you know, these were alone or in combination. That's one of the other confusing things. Remember, they can go along together. But the most frequently detected eukaryote was the fungus, Ephmosiae, in almost 80% of the samples. There's kind of a fungal biofilm that they've recovered in osteoarthritis. There's one in carotid atheroma. There's biofilm material in MS and in ALS. Remember, biofilms are specifically created by pathogens, and they're created in order to form a protective shell in which various of them can survive and share expenses. You know, they're renting in a condo, and they are all creating progressive damage, hardly easily available to our immune system or the inflammatory pathways that we use. The infection is taking advantage of hiding. But the story, like a blowfish, is much, much bigger. So Mensa invites us to think about cancer. Now, Simoncini has said, this is from 13 years ago, I think, cancer is a fungus. He offered a revolution in tumor therapy, and he actually was not the first to make any kind of a suggestion like this. But there are certainly some similarities between fungi and cancer. Both die in the absence of sugar. Both produce corrosive lactic acid. Both respond to antifungal medications. It should surprise all of us who've been trained classically. If you go look at anti-cancer medications, many of them are antifungal. If you go look at antifungal medications, many of them are anti-cancer. Well, are we perhaps focusing on, you know, really advanced treatment instead of the obvious? Well, tumorigenesis, inflammation has long been recognized as a major cause of tumor formation. 15% of human cancers are associated with chronic infection and inflammation. M-N. Okay. And acute and chronic inflammation-mediated tissue injury is observed in many organ systems, virtually all. Okay? Acute or chronic inflammation-mediated tissue injury. That's the disease that you are finding a very hard time recovering from because you lost the acute care battle. And so here's just some of the chemistry, just to show you there's actually some research on this. And the pro-inflammatory keeps cycling into the chronic inflammation. It gets worse, which is why patients gradually fade over time. Literally burnout. Inflammation is the common link among the leading causes of death. Now, there are studies showing that dietary components can modulate key pathways in the inflammation. The sympathetic activity, oxidative stress, the TNF-kappa-B, and pro-inflammatory cytokines, and so on. And what happens is you enter into the intrinsic pathways, you get chronic inflammation that you are unable to easily control, you get cancerogenesis. In other words, the situation is now ripe for the development of cancer somewhere or several where. And sure enough, you get the cancer. Once you get the cancer progression, that feeds into more chronic inflammation, and we see patients fade and fade. How about, here's another way of looking at it, okay, inflammation caused by environmental and dietary exposures. That's at 9 o'clock on your slide. Therapy-induced inflammation. Remember, chemo, surgery, all these radiation, these are all very aggressive things that produce inflammatory change inside us. Chronic inflammation, infection, and autoimmunity is at 3 o'clock. Wait a minute, that's immune-min. Wow, that's pretty cool. And tumor-associated inflammation itself creating problems, and that leads to not only tumor development, but tumor progression. And remember that someone who gets one cancer has a 10% greater chance of a non-similar independent cancer arising compared to the general population. And that's just from what we observe. It may be a lot more than that. Curcumin or flavonoids are the inflammation pathway controls on infection. And indeed, if you look, these are neat little things, scientific pathways for you to think about. But the polyphenolics, in other words, the plants, okay, show they can have a beneficial role in the preventing and then slowing the progression of chronic diseases related to inflammation. Diabetes, heart, so on and so forth. We ignore the bioflavonoids because we're off prescribing, you know, $6,000 a month cancer drugs. How sensible could that be? Well, you have to remember the plants have the same problem we do. They're biological beings that are being attacked, so they need antioxidants, antimicrobial, they are trying to do the same thing we are. Well, their products then can help us with allergies, inflammation, cancer, hypertension, microbial attack, and so on. So what about oncogenic changes? The model for that to help us understand the development not only of cancer but of other chronic diseases is the immune system, the inflammation, the infectious disease, all tied together in triggering the chronic inflammation and leading to other conditions. So Mensa invites us to consider just briefly toxic heavy metals. Lead toxicity, for instance, environmentally persistent toxin that leads to neurological, hematological, gastrointestinal, reproductive, circulatory, immunological, and it's all related to damaging the inflammation, damaging everything inside you by inflammation pathways. Now, it's not just burgers and fries that do the damage. Heavy metal exposure and atherosclerosis have been uniquely tied together. These findings have indicated the role of mercury in the pathogenesis of atherosclerosis and blood vessel damage, creating inflammation and dyslipidemia and so on. We have so many misconceptions in our doctors caring for us with cardiovascular disease. They completely overlook what are really well-documented reasons for it. Heavy metal toxins are virtually everywhere. There's lead, mercury, arsenic, cadmium, aluminum, nickel. These are in all the products that we are exposed to virtually on a daily basis. They cause inflammation, immune system dysfunction, neurotoxicity, contribute to arterial blockage. And don't forget, when you get these things, you're now wide open for infection. Think of it that way. Osteoporosis, well, MNN, the host response with bacteria, and then you've got soft tissue and bone destruction, and then more inflammation and so on. Osteoporosis is actually pretty straightforward and easy to fix if you have the global picture on it. It ain't the calcium in the bones. It's the body's responses going on. Same thing with neurodegeneration, MNN. And complex slide. You don't have to remember anything else, because I don't. And what you need to understand, though, is the periodontal brain nexus, because I keep coming back to periodontitis is perhaps the most important health challenge we have, because it is the easiest entry into the immunity, inflammation, infection cycle, okay? And so periodontitis, creating systemic inflammation and infection, and it goes to the brain, and then we've got neuroinflammation, and that's neuronal damage, and wait a minute, we're talking about promoting serious illness inside us, like that could be dementia, for example. And, you know, there may be pro-inflammatory genotypes or whatever. It's, you know, it's kind of irrelevant when we start talking about, oh, you got this SNP and you got that deficiency and such. the global big picture is what we have to have. We focus on this little piece, we miss the whole rest of it. That's how armies lose wars, you know. They're fighting over here while somebody is coming around behind them, and they've got them. And that was the battle of Texas liberation, as we surrounded Santa Ana, and bingo, got them. Neurodegenerative diseases, protein aggregation, neuroinflammation, immune activation, antibodies, immune cells, cytokines. It's all tied in. How about Parkinson's disease? Immunity, inflammation, infection, the oxidative stress, hypercoagulation syndromes. People go downhill not by one mechanism. They go downhill by all the mechanisms getting systemically activated in sequence. And when you have that, you are literally dying from the inside out. You get gut permeability, leading to more problems with systemic inflammation starting through the blood vessels, leading to the brain. You are dying. But, you know, dental mercury, the greatest exogenous sources of brain mercury come from dental amalgams. Who'd have thunk it, okay? How about mercury is 10 times more toxic to neurons than lead. And the hallmark changes in Alzheimer's disease include all these changes that can be caused by mercury. Could that be part of the start of the brain degeneration process? Neurotransmitters are inhibited in patients with Alzheimer's disease, the same inhibition that occurs in mercury toxicity. Other factors seen in Alzheimer's disease, changes such as increased platelet activation, poor odor identification, high blood pressure, depression, increased incidence of herpes virus, chlamydia infections, also occur in mercury exposure. Beginning to see the M and the N, immune and inflammatory diseases seen in patients with Alzheimer's also occur when cells are exposed to mercury. And these abnormalities in minerals and vitamins, specifically aluminum, calcium, copper, iron, magnesium, selenium, zinc, the list goes on, also occur in Alzheimer's and mercury toxicity. Pro-inflammatory cytokine expression, lymphoproliferation, autoantibody production, nephropathy, common outcomes. Hey, wait a minute. Mercury-induced inflammation and autoimmunity, we're talking the same thing. Idiopathic systemic autoimmunity. You know what idiopathic means, right? The idiots don't know the pathology, so. Oh, yeah, you can talk about that. Cadmium, inflammation, mitochondrial damage, likely. And, you know, the excessive reactive oxygen species we've talked about, toxic metals in cancer, underlying factor for carcinogenicity in metals is the generation of reactive oxygen species, free radicals. So Mensa invites us to look at arterial blockage, atherosclerosis and inflammation uniquely tied together, and the microorganisms in the arterial wall incite inflammatory response as well. So micro abscesses, well characterized. Plaque pathology, inflammation and high levels of microorganisms in the plaques. This is often from pathogenic archaea, similar single cell organisms similar to bacteria in human interior organ lesions. And pneumonia, you know, the bacteria and the mitral valves, common etiology related to infection and atherogenesis. Periodontal atheroma, you know, that basically is where we're doing the same process right there on the tooth itself. And could that be turning on the atherogenesis? There's a fair amount of suggestion that it is, and that links the intravascular plaque lining in the arterial lumen to the periodontal disease. And, you know, I've kind of shared that information with you, but what about emerging research relating inflammation and infection to atherosclerosis? If we're not looking at treating that, we won't be treating that, okay? Bacterial DNA was found in 95% of vascular biopsies, and most biopsies contain DNA from multiple species, not just one. Often, dental oral infections, and it may be even following toothbrushing and chewing. Periodontal pockets and atheromatous plaques are very similar in their microbial diversity, and detection of protozoa and fungi in arteriovascular disease, just now being looked at. The flammelliformis mosaei is certainly one being found in those situations. And so fungal components in the plaques, polymicrobial contribution, the biofilms, chronic inflammatory pathology. So Mensa worries about UMABs. You bet. Could our approach to treating various disease discomforts through immune attack, the biological drugs, be so misguided we're creating a whole new level of survival challenges for people? These are the monoclonal antibodies you see advertised on TV that take care of the psoriasis, the ulcerative colitis, the this and that and the other. Well, you remember you've got to talk to your doctor if you have had this, that, or the other. It might cause cancer and you could die. Well, because those things, the UMABs, are selective immune inhibitors, and that might mean you are really at risk for bacterial and fungal issues. Fungal defense, IL-17, important in inflammatory diseases, including psoriasis. We know what dysregulated IL-17 turns out to be particularly evident with a number of monoclonal antibodies, you know, targeting that. Plaque psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis, you know, I control a lot of those with just antifungals. Well, the IL-17 pathways now have been approved for quite some time and are used for the treatment of plaque psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis. How about, you know, cytokines, MN, you know, the IL-17 is important for immune function. And, you know, we're talking about then setting up autoimmunity and inflammation. And antifungal, adaptive immune cells, the TH1, TH17s, confer antifungal activity. And when you start damaging their approach, you get inflammatory cytokine production and antimicrobial peptides. And this is what they call success. For ulcerative colitis, the use of Entyvio, a UMAP, results in symptom remission in about 17% of people after 6 weeks, 42% after a year. For Crohn's, it's 15% and then 39% after a year. I'm not sure that's so successful because it's destroying your biology at the same time. But what if most of these are really related to infections? And we kind of documented a lot of that in the yeast syndrome book that I published in 1986. This is not all new information. We're getting more interest in it, but, you know, maybe treating the deep blood fungus is also another key to taking care of things with we have misguided approaches to what's really going on. Doctors routinely ignore MMN, and that's because the alterations in the gut microbiota have emerged as potential immune modulators. They have the capacity to induce physiologic or pathologic immune system, immune responses, and that can create inflammation. So we ignore the gut, but that might be absolutely critical. The microbiome is important to the immune system development in the first 2 to 3 years of life. And so what do? Prescribe routine antibiotics. Do we ever start to look at improving the gut? Not really. Strong evidence that microbes may contribute to many non-infectious chronic diseases like cancer and coronary heart disease. We've just gone through the evidence about how that MNN works in that cycle. So many of these diseases, inflammation has long been well known to be a symptom of infectious diseases. But you know, the research now concerns a lot of non-infectious ones, but I think really they're all infectious and we just don't see the infection. So Mensa observes that the basics, you know, just the color wheel, can become exuberant. In other words, we can have a phenomenal array of tools that we can use to help defend ourselves. But what if, Mensa asks, we have a defect or a distortion in the immunity or the infection or inflammation? In that situation, you might not be able to see what others see. In other words, you are open for more attack. What if your biological keyboard has a stuck or missing key? What about your piano? Instead of being part of the whole symphony, that's MNN, you actually, in chronic disease, look kind of like there's some missing parts. And what we try to do is kind of buttress you up rather than go find the root cause in order to restore and replace that. So Mensa asks about serious viruses, you know, the 1918 influenza, HIV, swine flu, bird flu, corona, Ebola, I mean, it just goes on, the list goes on, or even common viruses, Ebola, CMV, herpes, and so on. We have all these things that we're kind of familiar with, but remember, they're all being dealt with by specialists who are not looking at the bigger picture. And indeed, the bigger picture is going to emerge tomorrow, hopefully. But Mensa recognizes that the nexus is the integration or the active process of incorporating or combining the various elements into a whole. It's sort of a biological intersectionality. That sounded good too. I got to work on That's my next presentation, okay? Intersectionality is the interdependence, interrelatedness, co-equality, multiple axes of response intersect and co-construct one another at the macro and micro level. So it doesn't matter how you want to look at it, they all intersect one way and three others. It doesn't matter how, it's convenient for you, your visualization, they are all the same part, they are three sides of the same coin. Look at it whatever way you want, knock your socks off. If you start at immunity, you will end up with inflammation and infection. If you start at inflammation, you will end up with immunity and infection. If you start at infection, you will end up with immunity and inflammation. So Mensah asks, if MNN is true, then what changes with our diagnostic tests and treatment planning? So Mensah suggests it's really quite simple. MNN is illness, and that starts in your mouth for many, quote, healthy people. And so Mensah concludes the practice changes that can come from the new powerful understandings are very simple. Immune and autoimmune, treat and seek inflammatory links and infection links. Treat those. Inflammatory changes, treat and seek immune activation and infection. Treat those. Infection, treat and seek immune activation and inflammation. Treat those. In other words, become more global in what you're doing. What about puzzling clinical presentations? Assume and investigate for all three. Immune, inflammation, infection. Treat all. What about if they're failing to improve with the treatment? Investigate for immune, inflammation, an infection, treat all. What about recurrent illnesses? The same thing, investigate and treat for immune, inflammation, and infection. Deterioration of aging, investigate and treat for immune activation, inflammation, and infection. This changes everything. You become a specialist in fixing people's problems. So Mensah offers some simple health restoring and health maintaining strategies to start with every single patient that we see. Brush two or maybe three times daily. The reason the cell phone is on there is I understand there's more cell phones in the world than there are toothbrushes. Makes sense. Sugars and soft drinks, gone. More water, definitely. More vitamin C, as much as people tolerate. And Mensah asks, can healthy aging be prolonged? Yes, it certainly can. I think what we have to do is be aware of immunity, inflammation, and infection. So Mensah asks you now, do you suffer from a confirmation bias? Do you think no one is immune? Even Mensah's friends kind of suffer with that. There is safety in numbers because stragglers do get attacked. And standing out generally attracts attacks. We are all familiar with that. Still, Mensah asks, who are you? Will you stand up? Certainly you would be noticed, but Mensah adds, we see this. But the eagle sees survival. It depends on what you're looking at in the landscape. What you see is what you get. We are victims of our own delusions. We see the same data but different results. We have got to step back and see the bigger picture of MNN. We are trapped by our biases and think we have to stay on the merry-go-round. We've been trained that it's two-sided coins, but in actual fact, it's three-sided. MNN. So Mensah provocatively asks, are we shackled by Galen, whose ideas, restrained medicine for hundreds and hundreds of years? But what if we have many senses that are simply the ways that we monitor what's happening in our world in many different modalities? They're intertwined to give us a unique, powerful survey of our personal, internal, and external relationships. What if all of these senses are one surveillance system? Our sight and smell and touch and temperature, magnetic fields, hearing, taste, proprioception, balance, pain, and our body responses to immune challenges, inflammatory triggers, and pathogens of all kinds. One surveillance system? Are these just spins of the enmeshed observations that together comprise one system? Remember, survival is risky because we're threatened and under attack at all times. We often hide behind our shields. That's really not my field. You'll have to talk to so-and-so about it. But our job as doctors is to provide the right health strategies at the right time, every time. So Mensah suggests this is just the beginning. Immunity, inflammation, infection. For more perspectives, you can take a look at my website, Health Choices Now, because if you don't know you have choices, you don't have any. And thank you. You've been a wonderful audience, and I do appreciate you so much.